Welcome, everybody. How are we doing? Hello, hello. So we got a pretty interesting day ahead of us today. There's a couple things we need to do. I did not provision the Redis server, which is my own fault. You know, I realized like I kind of want to do all of this on stream as much as I can. There are definitely some things that I can't do live. Last time we left off, we set up a flexible server, a PostgreSQL flexible server on Azure. We were able to get all of that in Terraform, which was awesome. I haven't touched this database at all. It's still sitting here. You can see that it's been collecting metrics. So what we need to do now is we do in fact need to create this Redis server. And then after that, we're going to actually be migrating our API server. All right, cool. So let's go ahead and hop into it. So we need to create an Azure Redis server. Let's go ahead and do that. I'm going to assign it to my, oh, it automatically assigns it to you if you drag it. That's nice. So what do we want? We want to create a Redis server. So let's actually go into the portal here for a second. Let's go ahead and look and see what they have for offerings when it comes to Redis. Click create Redis cache. I think we're going to do that as well. And then we'll go ahead and just take a look at some stuff here. Okay. So we've got subscription as usual, right? And then we've got our resource group. Right now, it's just going to be whatever. This will be Quirk Dev. Right now, I don't even think we have 250 megabytes of cache being used. Cool. Okay, so we're going to need to make sure that we have a basic C0. Let's go to networking. Let's keep on basic then. That's fine. And let's go to networking again. And let's take a look at private endpoint. Now, private endpoint is basically what we've already done with our database. But what we're going to do is we're going to link this into our network so that it can exist on our subnet. I am going to be real. I don't really like the paywall around networking security requirements. Okay, so the premium tier is the only one that does that. So let's look at networking isolation options in general, because we do want to have a good understanding of how network isolation works with Redis. Okay, so the limitations here are network security groups are disabled for private endpoints. However, if there are other resources on the subnet, NSG enforcement will apply to those resources. Currently, portal console support and persistence to firewall storage accounts are not supported. The next one in this case, which is what we're going to be using, is Azure Private Link. The idea here is that because it is supported on basic, standard, and premium, what we can do with a private link at least is say, hey, we're going to make sure that this resource is disabled from public network access, and then we will poke a hole into our subnet so that it's almost like an emulated. So let's go ahead and do that. So now what we're going to do is we're going to go Terraform, Azure, Redis. Now remember, we're using Terraform for all of our stuff. So let's resource group, Redis cache. Okay. And this is basically what we want. Go ahead and go back here, and we're going to say touch. We're going to create a file really quickly, and this file is going to be called redis_cache.tf. All right, so let's go ahead and create a resource group here because we definitely want to create a resource group for everything that we have as long as we can. So we're going to go here and we're going to create our new resource group. And for this, we're going to say Redis. We're just following the same model here, right? We have our network resource group. We have our database resource group. And then we have our Redis resource group. Let's just focus on the main stuff. So for example, this is going to be self local.workspace, meaning that the name of this Redis instance will be quirk-dev. So at this point, we have a Redis instance or the ability to provision a Redis instance that is going to be in this resource group, will then be provisioned in US West somewhere. But if we think about it really carefully, we're missing some stuff. Like for starters, we want to make sure that this is not publicly accessible. So public network access enabled. Look at this, defaults to true with Terraform. So we want to disable this. If I had just ran that, I would have accidentally potentially provisioned a public Redis instance. So let's make sure that this is set to false. I actually really do like resource groups. I think it is a really neat concept. I don't know if it's 100% required, but I really do like it a lot. Okay, so let's look up storage accounts. So we're going to go to Terraform storage account. So we know we've already got our resource group. We're going to go ahead and copy this. Go ahead and go to storage account. And there we go. Okay, so I've got our storage account now, and we're going to call this the Redis storage account. What we could do is we could do quirk, and then instead of workspace, there's also an environment variable. And so what we'll do here is this is where all of our storage accounts will go. So if we need to create another one in the future, that's where it'll go. Now, you're going to notice that one of the things we wanted to do before was also networking. And so what we kind of need to do too is we need to make sure that this is on a subnet. So yeah, so basically what we're going to want to do is we're also going to want to make sure that we attach this to the virtual network. So we have our database subnet here. So let's go ahead and create a new subnet. And so this one is going to be our storage account subnet. the subnets need to be in the same resource group as the network itself. Name, and then the location is going to be storage account location. So the subnet here would be storage account, because we want this storage account to go in this subnet. I think this is okay for now. I'm just trying to think if there's anything else I need. So I know that I need a subnet. I know that I've already got the resource group with the network, that our virtual network, because remember, our virtual network's right here. And this is our virtual network for the whole workspace. So then we've got our subnet for databases. We've got our subnet for storage accounts. Okay, so let's go ahead and get this merged in, because I want to start getting some of this Terraform automation actually running. I'm actually going to go ahead and go to the resource group here, and I'm going to remove the Redis stuff. So now we're only creating the storage account and the storage account the resource group for the storage account, the storage account subnet. Perfect. Okay, cool. So let's go ahead and do this. I just need to move the Redis stuff. So I'm going to move Redis cache out of the directory just for the time being, because I want to commit without that. All right, let's go ahead and push this up. So when I push this up, we're going to go back to our repos. And in here, we should have a Terraform. There we go. There's our new pull request. When I create this merge request, what's going to happen is in a few moments, we're going to see updates from Terraform Cloud actually come in. It's going to see my changes. Yep, here they are. It's going to see my changes and it's going to immediately start running those plans to see if they error out or anything like that. Okay, so let's take a look at here. So Terraform will perform the following actions. Azure storage account will be created. So here's our resource group for our storage account. It'll be called Quirk Dev storage account for the resource group. And then finally, we've got the subnet itself. Cool. Look good. Yep. Virtual name, Quirk Dev. Okay, that looks good to me. So let's see if this is actually going to run. Okay, so let's go ahead and complete this really quickly. We're not going to complete the work item, but we are going to go ahead and delete the feature branch and squash and merge. So what this should do is this should merge the pull request. There's our plan. So now I can go to run and you can see here, there's our merge. And so again, we're right back to that same thing where you can see, all right, we had some stuff changed, no big deal. So the only thing I'm kind of like wondering about right now is if I actually need this subnet. I think I still may need it. So I'm going to go ahead and just apply this. Next thing we need to do is we need to add the Redis stuff, right? So I'm just going to grab that, bring that back in. So the resource group Redis is good. All right. So here's what we need to do now. So where it says this NC thing, right? What we want to do is we want to say storage account. Yeah. Storage account self primary blob endpoint. So that's what we want. So we want it to basically say the default endpoint protocol is HTTPS. The blob endpoint is our storage account self primary blob endpoint. The account name is the storage account self.name. And then account key is the Azure storage account self primary access key. So that should mean that we can do that. There's a couple other things we need to do, which is we're going to need to figure out how to set up a private link with it. So let's go back to Azure Cache for Redis. And we're going to go to networking tab. Now we want a private endpoint. So we need to create a private endpoint. So let's go to Terraform. This is going to be the Redis private endpoint. And the name on it is going to be local workspace Redis. Okay, so let's take a look at how exactly this is supposed to work. We're going to go with dev database for right now because it'll be dev Redis, but that's fine. The name for the endpoint, we'll just call it Quirk. To deploy the private endpoint, we're going to do Quirk Dev, virtual network, subnet. It's pretty much like how the database is, actually. So if we go to the PostgreSQL flexible server, we can see here that it depends on the private DNS zone virtual network link. And then if we flip these and we look at our virtual network link, I should now be able to say the DNS zone is the Redis name. The network is the same network, and then the resource group is Redis. Okay, so let's take a look here. Oh, cool. Okay, this looks good. So basically what's happening here is we get our resource group, bam. We then get our storage account, and then basically we create our Redis cache right there. And you can see here's our connection string, which is sensitive, which is awesome. All right, so I'm gonna go ahead and merge this and let's see if we can get this. And you can see it ran for both. Make sure that it works in both dev and prod. All right, so let's go ahead and merge this in and we're gonna get the resource group and the actual server itself created. All right, let's give it a shot. Let's see if it'll work. Confirm and apply. This is now going to essentially create all of those resources in the dev environment. And we should see them appear momentarily in the dashboard. So I'm going to just refresh. Okay, so let's go ahead and fix this so that we can get this Redis server up and running. Basically, all I had to do was just abandon it and then reinstate it or whatever, and it re-triggered the webhook. Resource group Redis has changed. It actually hasn't. It's just a small API update. So here we go. Create. So it's going to try creating that cache again. AOF, all that stuff is all of this is disabled now. We don't have to worry about any of this. And it's also going to destroy the subnet we don't need anymore either. Cool. Perfect. That looks good. All right. So we're going to approve this. And then I'm going to complete. And I'm going to complete merge. Now that that's done, we should essentially now be able to actually provision our Redis instance, have it available to us to configure, and we can then see how we set up private endpoints and all that good stuff. I mean, I'm very confident at this point this is gonna work. I was like, is it even showing up? Okay, cool. So it is in fact showing up. Here's our Redis cache. We now have our Redis instance deployed, and if I click on it, we can see it's right here. And we were able to actually finish this. So I want to show you guys why I created my issue first, or my user story first. I now have a user story 24, called Create Azure Redis Server. And because I created it because I started it at the beginning, I was able to attach all of my work to it. So one thing that's interesting about this is I said this was 4 story points. I was wrong. This was probably more about 6 story points. I can see how this whole thing went. And I could see this and go, yeah, this wasn't a 4. Like this amount of branching and trying things does not make this a 4 to me. This is at least a 5. And there we go. We have our second issue resolved. Our first one was creating our Azure PostgreSQL server and then our Azure Redis server. And now through that process, we've got our dev environment fully automated, and I can easily go into Azure and I can say, hey, there's my Azure cache. For Redis. The next thing that we have to do is migrate the API repository. So this is the first repository of the many that we have to do. We didn't get done what I wanted to get done today. What we did, we got the Redis server done, which is awesome. And we learned like a ton from it. And I'm really happy that like we literally got to where we are. But I also wanted to do the API repository as well as at least try and get our hands into pipelines. But yeah, thank you guys. Bye.